My heart will probably go crazy, and that's good. That's good for testing, because today I'm testing Polaris H10 versus Amazfit Neo. Ooh. Yeah, it's done. Ooh. Can't speak yet. Hello, YouTube people. This is Amazfit Neo. It's gonna be rather technical review. I'm gonna split it into three parts. In the first part, I would like to mention 10 points about this thing as a watch, then 6 points as a device, and then 6 points as a fitness tracker. And also at the end, I'm gonna do comparison to medical device which measures heart rate, and also comparison with Polaris H10 strapped on my chest while doing physical activity on elliptical trainer. We'll see how close this measuring device is to proper heart rate measuring devices. The strap on this watch is just wonderful, very good. Lots of holes, very breathable. Also, those holes are very close to each other, so finding the perfect fit is no problem. I mean, even Casio could learn a thing or two from this watch how to make a proper strap. Point number two is battery indicator. I mean, it goes without saying because it has a rechargeable battery, so it has battery indicator. But I wish all digital watches, even non-rechargeable ones, would have a battery indicator. Would be very helpful. And point number three is volt timer function. It is very good. On the app, I can easily add any city I want. I can remove, for example, I don't want to see Tokyo time. Hold it, delete it, that's it. And that's how it looks on the watch. So I can scroll through the menus, get to the world timer function, and now I can scroll through the cities that I set. So this is Los Angeles, minus 10 hours, London, minus 2 hours, New York City, minus 7. It's very nice that it also shows the difference in time. So this world timer function is very, very good. Point number four, it has 50 meters of water resistance. I mean, this is fitness watch after all. If it wouldn't have at least 50 meters of water resistance, it would be a total failure in my opinion. But this one gets a pass. You can actually swim with this watch. And as a watch, it has very good stopwatch function. So this is the stopwatch. Let's start the stopwatch. And for example, there are 5 persons running and you have to time them all. So first person, second person, third, four, five. And that's it, stop. So I can now scroll down and see the times that people did. So first person finished in 7 seconds, then 8 seconds, 9 seconds. And let's see how many times I can store and stop. So in total, I can store 10 times. Yeah, so it's very good stopwatch. Number 6 is the looks of the watch. As my wife has described, this watch looks like old Microsoft Windows. Probably that's why some people feel a little bit nostalgic when speaking about the design of this watch. I don't know. This design is not offensive, not out of place. There is nothing gimmicky and nothing supposedly to make this watch better looking or whatever. Like, I mean, look at this G-Shock. This is madness. This is crazy. This is style over style. You like it, you hate it, doesn't matter. But this is like extreme. This is extreme. And this is simple. This is just a nice watch. Nice, simple watch. Point number 7 is the backlight. The backlight shines for 10 seconds. For 10 seconds, unless you hold the button once again and stop it. And while the backlight is shining, you can scroll through the menus and use the functions. Very helpful. Only there is one thing. This backlight is incredibly strong. Let me demonstrate how it feels like checking the time in the middle of the night. For example, at 4 a.m. I want to check the time and turn on the backlight. And oh my God, it takes like 4 seconds for my eyes to adjust. Okay, now I can see the time. So it's kind of okay that it lasts 10 seconds because half of the time it takes my eyes to adjust to the bright light. It's too bright, it's stupid. Now, don't forget we are still talking about this item as a watch. And number 8 is, it has no alarm function. I mean, it does have alarm function, but you have to set it on the phone. And what's the point? I can set the alarm for the phone on the phone. Why would I set the alarm on the phone for the watch? So it misses that function. And straight next to another point, point number 9, it doesn't have a timer function. As smart as it is, it doesn't have a timer function. This is stupid. Number 10, the date is too small, difficult to see. It is very small. These numbers are actually kind of difficult to see. I mean, there is a lot of space. It could be displayed in a bigger format, but now these numbers are extra tiny, so it's kind of, you know, a little bit negative. Okay, so those were all the points speaking about it as a watch. So as a watch, on my website thomaswatchreviews.com, I would put it on not bad as a watch without speaking about other functions. But now let's move on and speak about other functions. So I have 6 points to mention speaking about it as a device. The first point, battery life. Battery life is surprisingly good. Me, honestly, I haven't worn this watch long enough to kill the battery. Point number 2, phone finder function. You have to hack the watch in order to use phone finder function. I mean, you have to press back button, then up button, hold them, and it tries to find the phone, but why can't find my phone? What the hell? It shows finding the phone. Look, and it didn't find the phone. What the hell? The phone is here. Maybe that's why I have set do not disturb mode on my phone, so nobody can call me and send SMS messages. Okay, let's try it again. I turned off do not disturb mode on the phone. Now let's try looking for the phone again. What? This is stupid. I mean, it's stupid two ways. First of all, you aren't gonna find your phone if do not disturb mode is turned on. I have just found that out. I didn't know. And another thing is, how often you're gonna use this function? You're gonna use this function only when you are in the same room where is the phone. Otherwise, it wouldn't work. So you kind of have to use it when you drop your phone in the between the seats in the car in that black hole. That could be helpful. But you guess what? You won't remember the combination, what buttons to press. This is stupid. It should be just scroll down menu function like find phone. That's it. Press the button, the phone starts ringing. But no, instead you have to remember this kind of crazy combination. You won't remember that. Number 3, weather function. It's kind of helpful, especially for me right now in the winter time. I can see that it's cloudy or snowy or rainy, and it shows right now it's from 0 to 4 degrees Celsius. So I know how much do I have to dress up before going out. So it's helpful. As a device, number 4, notifications. You can connect your watch to the phone, so when the phone is ringing, your watch will also be ringing. I never understood such things, and it's on Bluetooth, so it's only gonna work when you are in the same room as your phone. So your phone starts ringing, your watch starts ringing. Why would you want that? I never understood that, but somehow I just wanted to mention this point. As a device, number 5. Well, it goes without saying, but the display is always on, like on some kind of Casio watch. But it doesn't really is the case with a lot of smartwatches and fitness watches. And with this one, you always see everything. And it has one interesting function, where you tilt the wrist and backlight starts shining. And you can also schedule that function, for example, from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. Because it doesn't have light sensor, so it doesn't know it's bright or it's dark. So that scheduling helps. But I found that function a little bit annoying. For example, I work next to PC right now. I kind of move my wrist a little bit and it starts shining and it starts shining and it just distracts me. So I found that automatic backlight function a little bit distracting. But anyway, it does have that. As a device, number 6, the last point as a device, it's the app. This app is stupid. It's very difficult to use. It's not logically laid out. It's complete mess. For example, when I was using G-Shock app, it was something like using Canon camera.
All menu is laid out in very logical order, very easy to find everything. You don't need to remember anything because everything is very easy to find. Where this app is more like old Sony camera, where you go into menus and there are sub-menus and you just keep scrolling and scrolling and scrolling and you can't find anything really. So the same problem with this app. There are menus, there are sub-menus, and sub-menus there are other sub-menus, and it's just a complete mess. So anyway, using this app is a little bit difficult, so that's negative. So those are all the points as a device, 6 points as a device. Now I have 6 points as a fitness tracker. And first point is kind of stupid. You know, you start that training program and for example, you want to rest in the middle of the training and the watch decides that you have stopped training and stops the workout, which is very annoying actually. I found out that yesterday. Polaris kept going, but this watch decided, oh, the training it must be over because you're sitting and resting and just stopped. So that's stupid. As a fitness tracker, number two. So also noticed that yesterday because the watch stopped when I was resting. So I wanted to initiate it once again to raise my heart rate, doing some push-ups and compare the results to Polaris H10. So instead I have started this one again. And you know what? Just doing 10 push-ups and stopping the training program. The training is not long enough, so it doesn't store anything. How stupid is that? I mean, I just wanted to see how high my heart rate was gonna go from doing just 10 push-ups. And I cannot record that because training session is too short. This, what? As a fitness tracker, number three. Number three is negative. You see, right now I'm doing some kind of activity, right? And that's the view you're gonna see. And the problem is that when I'm doing some kind of fitness activity where I have to act accordingly to my heart rate, I simply cannot see my heart rate. If I'm, for example, running and I have to act accordingly to my beats per minute, you know, I have to step up or slow down a little bit. Whenever I run, try seeing the small number right now. I mean, this is stupid. This is unusable. Unless you are just working out in the gym and resting between sets and waiting for your heart rate to go down. Yes, this is very helpful. But whenever you're actually doing something and in the middle of activity you have to act accordingly to the heart rate, forget it, you ain't gonna see it. Number four as a fitness tracker. It is kinda stupid because it has only three programs. It has running, walking and cycling. But what if I wanna do just simple training at the gym or whatever, you know, I don't care about steps, about the distance, just show me heart rate and show me the chart of my heart rate. That's it, that's all I care. But instead, it has those things where you have to be constantly moving. So for example, if you're training in the gym, you wanna do something between sets to rest, okay, take a break. And the watch decides that you stopped training and stops the program. And there is no such program that would be going without stopping. As a fitness tracker, number five. Okay, right now the heart rate monitoring is set to the most accurate one, so it measures heart rate continuously. Now let's compare the results together with this medical device, with this thing on my arm. Okay, 83 and 80. I would say that's close enough. That's very close. 82, 80, 81. Yeah, that's actually good. That gets passed for me. As a fitness tracker, number six, the final one, the most interesting one, the comparison between this watch and Polaris H10. It's 8 p.m. right now. I'm feeling super lazy, haven't had much time today, but it has to be done. My heart will probably go crazy, and that's good. That's good for testing, because today I'm testing Polaris H10 versus Amazfit Neo. So let's start Polaris H10, okay? And with Amazfit Neo, there isn't anything like trainer. So I'll just simply start walking program. Got it. Okay. So Amazfit Neo has started as well, as I can see. First of all, I gonna go easy, 5 minutes easy, then 5 minutes increasingly more and more and difficult, and after total 10 minutes, 2 minutes just cool off. So let's start the fun. Cool off, cool down, 2 minutes, yeah boy. Ooh. Yeah, it's done. Ooh. Can't speak yet. I went a little bit too hard. It's not good, it's just breaking yourself, but I did it for science. Now I'm not stopping yet, I'll wait till I totally cool down, then maybe I'm gonna do some push-ups once again, just to raise my heart rate very quickly again, then I'm gonna rest. And we're gonna compare the results. So I was just sitting down waiting for my heart rate to calm down, and it beeped and my training completely stopped. And even now I pause and start again, it doesn't start going once again. So I don't know, Polaris is still going fine. So what I'm gonna do is actually stop, record all the data and start it once again. Okay, let's start it once again. Heart rate went down to 115, something like that. So I would say it's fine to start doing something once again. So just for comparison to Polaris, let's do 10 simple push-ups. Nothing too crazy, just raise my heart rate once again. Now let's see how it goes. I'll just show you Polaris. Polaris goes like that, 159, 160. So looking at the chart, great success. Looking at Amazfit Neo, it doesn't really follow. Anyway, let's stop everything on my phone.
Workout pause.
And we'll compare it to Polaris. Well, for some reason, Amazfit Neo failed to engage to the next activity. It didn't record anything. Well, I don't know. And for some reason, I decided to stop once I was resting for a little bit, and it decided to stop completely. Maximum heart rate 198, and on Amazfit Neo 194. Okay, to give you a better view, I will show you some pictures. So first picture, keep in mind one thing, I can track time stamps accurately only on Amazfit Neo, which is on the top, which shows 5 minutes, but on the bottom Polaris doesn't really show accurate timestamps, might be a little bit inaccurate, but roughly heart rate on the top shows 152 on Amazfit Neo, and on the bottom Polaris shows 153. Which is, well, surprisingly close, to be honest. Another picture is at 10 minutes, roughly. So at 10 minutes, Amazfit Neo registers 191, while Polaris shows 190. Surprisingly close. 15 minute mark. So keep in mind, it's roughly, I cannot really set 15 minutes on Polaris, but roughly heart rate is also shown the same, 141 on Amaz and 140 on Polaris. And on the resting stage at 20 minutes mark, Amazfit Neo shows 119, while Polaris shows 122. So also surprisingly close. It's a shame that Amazfit Neo decides to stop when you are in a resting stage. That doesn't really make sense to me, but yeah, whatever. Maybe it tries to save battery, but then again, why Polaris doesn't try to save battery? So yeah, it's not a professional device. Anyway, 35 euros, 25 euros, something in between that range. It's ridiculous value for money. I mean, even comparing to some Casios. Casios usually the best value for money on the market. But this watch is like head and shoulders above any Casio for the money. It's ridiculous. If this watch was Casio, I believe it would easily be at least 150 euros. So it's just insane what you get for the money. And now comes the difficult part. Where I gonna place this watch on my website, thomaswatchreviews.com, where I rate watches into different tiers. You see, when I rate some kind of a Casio, I place it in some kind of a tier, that's it. It stays there for many years, nothing gonna change. This, however, I place in some kind of a tier list, like 1 year later it's gonna be old technology. But for now, as it is, I'm gonna put it into keepers for this year, and for next year I'm gonna put this watch into keepers because it's that good. It's really good and surprisingly accurate heart rate monitoring as well. So not for professional use, but overall I'm pretty surprised how good it is. I thought it's gonna go just 220 beats per minute and then it's gonna lose everything, but it tracks surprisingly well, as you saw from the pictures. Anyway, the video is already too long. Anyway, thank you for your patience. Have a beautiful day. Goodbye.